Good morning. Thank you for connecting with us. Let's magnify him. Let's thank God for his love. For his love is deep and wide, and nothing can separate us from it. We welcome you.
We rise and declare that no one nowhere compares to your love. You are holy. We stand and we shout. We can't live without your love. For you are holy, God. Oh, 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 oh.
Yeah.
the king shall joy in thy strength. O Lord, and in thy salvation, how greatly shall he rejoice. Thou hast given him his heart's desire, and hast not withheld the request of his lips. For thou preservest him with the blessings of goodness. Thou settest a crown of pure gold on his head. He asked for life of thee, and thou gavest it to him, even length of days forever and ever. His glory is great in thy salvation, honor and majesty hast thou laid upon him. For thou hast made him most blessed forever. Thou hast made him exceeding glad and thy countenance. For the king trusteth in the Lord, and through the mercy of the Most High he shall not be moved. Be thou exalted, Lord, in thine own strength, so we will sing and praise thy power. Yes. Be thou
exalted, Lord, in thine own strength. Be thou exalted, Lord, in thine own strength.
Come on, sing it with us.
Be thou exalted, Lord, in thine own strength. Be thou exalted, in thine own strength.
Be thou, come on and sing it.
Be thou exalted, Lord, in thine own strength. Be thou exalted, Lord, in thine own strength.
Be thou.
Be thou exalted, Lord, in thine own strength.
So we will sing.
So we will sing and praise. And praise thy power. So we will sing and praise. And praise thy name. Ha. So we will sing and praise. And praise thy power. In thine own grace, be thou exalted, Lord, in thine own grace.
We thank you for your grace.
Be thou exalted, Lord, in thine own grace.
Be thou.
Be thou exalted, Lord, in thine own grace.
This morning we sing and praise.
So we will sing and praise. And praise thy power. So we will sing and praise. And praise thy name. So we will sing and praise. And praise thy power. So we will sing.
In thine own love.
In thine own love.
Agape.
Be thou exalted, Lord. In thine own love.
We thank you for your love.
Be thou exalted, Lord. In thine own love. Be thou exalted.
Time, so we will sing.
So we will sing and praise. Praise thy power.
Yes. Oh, we saturate this place right now. Oh, we saturate this place right now with worship. Go ahead and fill your room with the worship of the Lord. Come on and lift your voice and worship the Lord right now. You are exalted, God, above heaven and the earth. You are exalted above all, God. Oh, we exalt you, we exalt you. Be exalted, God, be exalted above every name. Be exalted, God, above every situation. Be exalted above every condition. Be exalted, God, above our present circumstance. Be exalted, Father. We set our affections on you and we turn our hearts to you because you are able and you are strong and you are Lord. You are powerful. You are good and your mercy endures forever. Your mercy endures throughout all generations. So we on purpose magnify you. We on purpose glorify you. Be enlarged in our living rooms. Be enlarged over our houses. Be enlarged in our bedrooms. Be enlarged right now where we are. Be enlarged, God, right now in Jesus' name. Be enlarged, God, over lack and over sickness and disease. In every spirit of infirmity, be enlarged over it, God. Be enlarged over darkened eyes and blind eyes and closed ears. Be enlarged, Father. Let your word have free course. Let your word, God, do what it does best. It uproots, God. It changes minds and hearts. And God, we thank you for illuminating your word, God, by your spirit. And causing change and transformation by your grace. And we choose to bless you. We say, be thou exalted, God. Be thou exalted, Lord. We exalt you because you're wonderful. We exalt you because you're strong. Thank you. for you alone deserve all glory. For you alone deserve all praise. Father, we worship and adore you. Father, we long to see your face. For you deserve all glory. For you alone deserve all praise. Father, we love you and we worship you this day. And it says you are the peace. You are the peace that guards my heart, my help in time of need. You are the hope that leads me on and brings me to my knees. For there I find you waiting, and there I find with all my heart I worship, and unto you I'll sing. For you alone deserve all glory. For you alone deserve all praise. Father, we worship and adore. Father, we long to see your face. For you alone deserve all glory. For you alone deserve all praise. Father, we love you and we worship you this day. Jesus, we worship you. Jesus, we worship you. Jesus, we worship you. Come on, you sing tall. Jesus, we worship you. Jesus, we worship you. Jesus, Jesus, we worship you. We worship you, Jesus. Jesus, we worship you. Jesus, we worship you. Father, we love you. Father, we love you. And we worship you this day. Father, we love you. Father, we love you, and we worship you this day. Father, we love you. Father, we love you, and we worship you this day. We commit this time to you. Your kingdom come, your will be done. Thank you.
Amen. Glory to God. Good morning. Good morning. Can we just continue in that? Lord, for you alone, God, deserve all glory. For you alone, deserve all praise, Lord. God, and we love you and we worship you this day, God. We say that there was nobody like you, Lord Jesus. We thank you for your presence even now, God. We honor you. We appreciate you so much. God, and we thank you, Lord, for the manifestation of your kingdom even this day, Lord, even in the midst of our praise, even in the midst of our worship. God, we honor you. We love you. We give you glory. We give you honor, Lord. And we say that it's this day that we do it. God, we're not waiting for tomorrow. We're not waiting for any quote unquote special occasion, God, but you are special and you are the reason, God, of our adoration, of our worship. Lord, so we do invite your presence, God, even as we've been singing and exalting your name, Lord, we invite your presence and say more. God, we thank you for the more of your presence right now. And we receive you. We receive you afresh, God. And I thank you, Lord, for just fresh expectation, for fresh faith today, God. I thank you, Lord, for just even reviving things, God, and activating and stirring things on the inside of our heart and in our lives, God. And I thank you, Lord, that it's not just information, but it's impartation and activation, revelation and manifestation in Jesus' name. Come on, in Jesus' name, amen. Glory to God. And so we do thank God for his presence. That's why we're here. We're here to worship him. We're here to pray and to seek his face and to be in his presence. And I do thank God for Pastor Gabriel and Minister Marlena today for just ushering in the presence of the Lord for this moment, for such a time as this. So we do thank God for them as well. And I'm telling you, it's just on. And so, you know, again, we do reverence him. We do worship him. And again, I don't take it lightly. If you're joining us for the first time, we say welcome. Thank you so much for taking time to join us. You can even let us know in the chat that you're part of the stream for the first time today or however you might be connecting. And we don't take it lightly that you joined with us. And so we're praying for you as well. Amen. That just the presence of the Lord just really just manifests in a special way on the inside of you and around you and through your lives, that you know that his hand is good upon you because God loves you. And so again, we say welcome. Welcome, Lord. We love you. We're ready to just enter into the word at this moment. So it's been on. Again, I personally want to thank everybody for just journeying and sticking with us, even as we've been going line upon line through the book of Nehemiah. On my way here, I know one thing that I believe the Lord really spoke to my heart. And again, this is something that I don't even have the fullness of, but he was like, look, even what you're ministering, it's like you don't even understand the fullness of the importance and how it might seem like it's Old Testament, but it's still such a present word right now. And because just to let some people know, I have an affinity. I haven't been there yet. In my heart, I have, but my feet haven't touched the grounds of Jerusalem yet. But I remember I have prayer journals and prayer diaries of just praying for Jerusalem and praying towards Jerusalem. So just even, you know, going through this, and I know God still has plans for the city. And this doesn't make national news and this doesn't make major media news, but there is a restoration of the old city, of the city of David, that is taking place. And so there's some prophetic things that are being shaken off and dusted off, so to speak. And some of the things that prophets, Isaiah, you know, has even spoken that is happening. And so this word is actually speaking and coming from a multi-layered level. So it's speaking about Jerusalem, but here's the awesome thing. It's speaking about us, and it's speaking about us even now, because again, even while things are being built and God is doing a work and manifesting his word over there, guess what? It's also happening for us because we are his living temple that he resides in. And so there's some things that I believe that through this word, that some things are being built and rebuilt and established and reestablished, because God's got plans for you, because he wants his glory to be seen through your life and through my life. And so as we've been going through Nehemiah, just understand that it's revival in the midst of us. And of course, it can come up in different forms and fashions. But I mean, if you got a revival of hope, if hope is being revived, if affection, if our hearts for God is being revived, then that's what it's about for such a time as this, because the world, they're hopeless. But if we have hope that has been revived, then guess what? We know that that true hope comes from Him, and God is desiring to use us and to position us to be those lighthouses, to be those beacons, and to be those conduits of His goodness and of His power and of His love, so that way they can receive of it as well. Amen. So again, I thank you as we've been going through this. And so I'm excited. We're actually this past Wednesday, if you didn't hear that word when we talked about hammers and swords coming from Nehemiah chapter 4, take a moment either later today or throughout this week. Go back and listen to it. I know there's a lot of things that were shared in it and some weighty things. So that's why it's worth a couple of listens and digestions, but it is all good. I believe that the word God gives today, it'll still be weighty, but very helpful as well, you know, as we continue on in this building and rebuilding season. Man. So just be excited. And again, somebody just say, it is on. So we came from Nehemiah chapter 4, just talking about hammers and swords and Nehemiah, you know, dealing with Sanballat and Tobiah and Geshem, but you know, how he had to deal with people that conspired against him and those apostate voices and the areas in which they attacked and how they spoke. And so we have that. And then, of course, I'm not going to deal with chapter 5. We're actually going to be in chapter 6 today. But in chapter 5, it was just an outcry of the people. And of course, Nehemiah, you know, he lets us know that, you know, he's in a governing position now. So he's not just a cupbearer doing this work, but he himself is actually a governor in this Judah region, overseeing and governing this work. So now we pick it up in chapter 6, because now they are progressing very strong. Pretty much the walls have been built up. You know, when we looked at it before, it was halfway, but now they have been built up. And so we're going to see what's happening, because these three people, they've just been hating and talking, speaking against this apostolic work the whole time. And so what we're going to see today, if you've seen in the title, we're actually going to talk about the power of yes. I believe. Yeah. So just the power of just the yes and no, even in this apostolic work, because your yes to God is weighty. Your yes to God means something. But at the same time, when you're saying yes to Him, you're saying no to several things, but you have to stand in that. And so we're going to see that today. So I'm in a New King James Version, Nehemiah chapter 6. I like turning these pages, y'all. I like turning these pages. It's just something, you know, I can't write in you know, in a digital version, but I can write in these scriptures, and there's just a whole lot that just comes out. But here we go. Verse 1. Now it happened when Sanballat, Tobiah, Geshem, the Arab, and the rest of our enemies. So Nehemiah is dealing with a lot. And the rest of our enemies heard that I had rebuilt the wall and that there were no breaks left in it. Somebody just say that the walls are rebuilt and there are no breaks left in it. Remember how we talked about closing the gaps? So the gaps are closed. That I had rebuilt the wall and that there were no breaks left in it, though at the time I had not hung the doors and the gates. Verse 2, that Sanballat and Geshem sent to me saying, come, let us meet together among the villages in the plain of Ono. But they thought to do me harm. And so we see that Sanballat and Geshem, they were saying, hey, come on. They're hearing about the walls that have been rebuilt. And so they were saying, hey, well, come, let's get together. Let's talk about some things, Nehemiah. And so they sent this message. And so Nehemiah says this in verse 3. So I sent messengers to them saying, I am doing a great work. Yeah, I am doing a great work so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease while I leave it and go down to you? I got to say verse 3 one more time, and we're going to pause after this. So I sent messengers to them saying, I am doing a great work so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease while I leave it and go down to you? Somebody just say right now, I am doing a great work. Oh, say it again. Say, I am doing a great work. You know, it's something, you know, and again, I got to kind of give late. I got to say this again, how this all kind of came about, because God has been just putting a track record for us here. And so, again, I know he spoke. I believe it. I don't even just say I know it now that he spoke to my heart, but I'm going to give you the ability to focus. And then, you know, he gave Apostle a word just talking about being in the zone. And so marrying those two things together, I know that there are some things that God wants to do with us and for us. But focus, being focused is so key. And so, that is very critical. So now, as we've been dealing with this, you know, there's actually a book that I have. I actually have it in three different versions. I have a digital copy. I have a hard copy. I couldn't find my hard copy. It's boxed up somewhere. But then I also have an audio version. So while I was going, as we've been talking about focus, you know, I believe the Lord just reminded me. It's like, hey, there's this book by this gentleman named Gary Keller called The One Thing. And it just talks about, you know, just discovering your one thing and really just kind of focusing in on that. So I've been, as I've been going through scripture, you know, I've been reading this as well. And so Gary Keller actually has this one story that really ties in with what I believe that God gave us for today. And he talks about just the four thieves that kind of can take away from focus. And so he begins with this story here. And he says, in 1973, a group of seminary students unknowingly participated in a grand study known as the Good Samaritan Experiment. So this is 1973, and these are seminary students in the study. These students were recruited and divided into two groups to see what factors influenced whether or not they would help a stranger in distress. Some were told that they were going to prepare a talk about seminary jobs. The others, they were going to give a talk about the parable of the Good Samaritan. All right. And so for many of us, we know about that story, which is a biblical story about helping people in need. Within each group of these two groups now, some were told they were late and had to hurry to their destination, while others were told they could take their time. What the students didn't know was that the researchers had planted a man along the way, slumped on the ground, coughing and apparently in distress. In the end, check this out. In the end, fewer than half the students stopped to help. But the deciding factor wasn't the task. It was time. 90% of the students who were rushed failed to stop and render aid to the stranger. Some actually stepped over him in their hurry to get where they were supposed to go. It didn't seem to matter that half of them were on the way to deliver a talk on helping others. My goodness. Now, he says this, now seminary students can so easily lose focus on their real priority. And he says, do the rest of us even have a prayer? And I say, yes, we do. We're going to talk about that today. But he says, clearly, our best intentions can easily be undone. And then he says, it's up to you to stop these thieves in their tracks. And so when he talks about the four thieves of productivity, I was like, oh, my gosh, this so falls in line with what scripture has already said, because he says the first thief is the inability to say no. The inability to say no. So saying yes to God means that you're going to say no to quite a few opportunities and invitations or so, but you got to stand in that because that's required for focus and to build. And so we see Sanballat and Geshem. So they send a messenger to Nehemiah saying, hey, come, let's meet in this plain of oh no. Somebody say, oh no. Say, oh no, I ain't meeting you in oh no. So they said, let us meet in oh no. But Nehemiah said that they thought to do me harm. And of course, I got to say this again, verse 3. So I sent messengers to them. I am doing a great work. I am doing a great work so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease while I leave it and go down to you? So Nehemiah had already established a yes. It had already been something in his heart. So he had already established a yes and saying, hey, you know, we're going to build these walls. And the people said that we're going to build these walls and restore these gates, which have been burned down. So that yes was so strong and it was embedded in him. But you see how the enemy time and time and time again, try to get him to move from that, try to get him to move from that. So somebody just say right now, I am not coming down. Yeah, somebody say right now, because I believe many people, God has got you in a position of faith and God has got you in a position of focus and God has got you in such a place of being in his presence and that the enemy's trying to present a whole bunch of opportunities and scenarios to get you off of that. But somebody just declare right now and say again, I am not coming down. Yeah, so we're not coming down from this place. As a matter of fact, I say this, we're going to keep ascending and going deeper and going further. So at the same time, we're going higher and our roots are digging deeper. All right, so here we go. So he says that, look, I am not leaving this good work. So I just want to encourage somebody right now for the good work that God has already begun and that he's already placed his hands on, that you're beginning to place your hands on, and you're beginning to apply your effort and work as well. Don't cease from it. And I think some people, this is just a word just ahead of a time, just so that way you're aware of the enemy's tactics and schemes. We already talked about on Wednesday some of the different areas that the enemy will try to attack your identity. He'll try to attack your ability and strength, your worship, and your work. And so we see this work here that the enemy's trying to stop this work. And sometimes it could come from the outside, and sometimes it could be those inner verses that be like, ah, man, you know, I'm just going to quit. Let me just stop. But that's not going to be us, especially when you're at the forefront of completion. Look, the walls are up. He just had to continue putting the gates on. So don't stop, because some of you, so let me just say this right now. Some of y'all are probably already at the finish line, but you just don't see it yet. So don't cease in your well-doing. Don't stop in your well-doing. I believe that's a word for somebody. Continue on. Stay in his presence. It'll be fruitful. Amen. All right. And so then he says this, verse 4. But they sent this message to me. This is amazing. But they sent this message to me. How many times that do you see there? 4 times. So they said it once, and then they sent the messenger again, and then they sent the messenger again, and then they sent the messenger again 4 times. But this is what I love. And I answered them. This is what Nehemiah said. They sent this message to me 4 times, and I answered them in the same manner. So he had to say in the same manner, I am doing this great work. I am not coming down. That was 1 time. Messenger comes again. I am doing this great work. I am not coming down. That's 2 times. I am doing this great work. I am not coming down. That's 3 times. I am doing this great work. I am not coming down. Why should this work cease for me to come and meet you? Oh, let me just say this right now, man. You got to guard your time. You've got to guard your time, man. When you're focused, when you've given your yes and you've committed your yes to the Lord, because guess what? It's not just a verbal commitment. It's a whole life commitment. It's a whole life commitment, because many people honor God with their lips, but their hearts are far from him. But that's not going to be us. When we say yes, it's the full thing. Oh, it's our full weight. It's all. Guess what? When you say yes to the Lord, guess what else has to say yes? Your mind. When you say yes to the Lord, guess what else has to say yes? Your body. Oh, so your body, even though it might have its own cravings, but even your body can't do anything, because now your body has to submit to the yes that has come out of your spirit and has come out of your mouth. So somebody just say, mind, line up to the yes. Somebody just say, body, line up to the yes. And now that means now we have to guard our time, because many people say, hey, you know what? Oh, yeah, you have to guard against the time wasters. Because people might have even good intentions. Hey, let's get together. But if sometimes some of those things you kind of just have to pause and guard against, because when you are focused, when you're about building some things, then you just can't have any type of conversation that gets your mind off track or going down memory lane. Oh, yeah, you remember when we used to do such and such, such and such? Nah, I don't remember. I forget those things which are behind, and I'm pressing towards the mark of the high calling of Christ Jesus. And they might look at you funny, but that's okay, because you've given your yes to Jesus. Oh, so here we go. I heard this quote right here. It says, one yes must be defended over 1,000 by. Okay, let me say this again. One yes must be defended over time by 1,000 no's. I got to say that, because when I saw that, when I read that, I was like, wow. One yes must be defended over time. Over time now by 1,000 no's. We're going to continue on at this, but this is so strong. Yeah. So he says again, so I answered them in the same manner. So he gave them a no by that messenger. Verse 5. Then Sanballat, as a matter of fact, even before I go there, you remember Jesus? He even gave the scripture. When we're talking about yes and no, remember when Jesus said this, let your yes be yes and let your no be no. And I know he was talking about that in the form of oaths. As a matter of fact, let's just turn there real quick, just so you can see that. Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. Someone's like, oh my gosh, we're out of Nehemiah. It's all connected. It's all a thread. Matthew chapter 5, verse 33 through 37. I just want you to see this, because Jesus said it. And he says, again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform your oaths to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all. Meaning don't swear. Yeah, don't swear at all. Neither by heaven, don't swear by heaven, for it is God's throne. Don't swear by the earth, for it is God's footstool. Nor by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great King. Verse 36, nor shall you swear by your head, because you cannot make one hair white or black. Ain't that the truth? Because I'm seeing white hair showing up on my beard and I had nothing to do with it. Verse 37, but let your yes be yes and your no be no, for whatever is more than these is from the evil one. And that's a whole lot there. But again, I just want to solidify the fact that your yes has to be yes. And then your no has to be no. And so what happens is over time, the enemy will try to see if you get up off that. But somebody say, I am not coming down off that. And even people will come. People will come and try to get you off focus. And then they'll have come up with an ideal, or it could be their ideal, or even they could be used by the enemy. And next thing you know, you done lost time, or you done looked at something that you didn't need to look at, because maybe they sent the YouTube link. Oh, check this out. And then you look at it, and then you start looking at another thing, and then another thing, and then another thing, and then you done lost time. No, our yes is going to be yes, and our no is going to be no. I feel the Holy Ghost right now. Verse 5, then Sanballat sent his servant, because now after they were denied four times, guess what? They still didn't stop. Then Sanballat sent his servant to me as before, the fifth time, with an open letter in his hand. In it was written, check this out, my God. In it was written, it is reported among the nations. And Geshem says that you and the Jews plan to rebel. Therefore, according to these rumors, you are rebuilding the wall that you may be their king. And you have also appointed prophets to proclaim concerning you at Jerusalem, saying there was a king in Judah. Now, remember, the king was Artaxerxes over the whole area. But this is what they're saying. Now these matters will be reported to the king, which is King Artaxerxes. So come, therefore, let us consult together. So now, Sanballat sent this open letter lying. Now, remember how we talked about how they wanted to bring confusion and how they conspired together and how they were so critical of the work? But now after all this, after trying to bring confusion, after conspiring together and being critical, now he's saying, hey, let's consult. Hey, Nehemiah, hey, you know what? Now that I'm seeing that this didn't work. Hey, Nehemiah, let us consult together. Let's have a conversation. Let me give you some consultation. And so, man, you got to be wise even and discerning. I got to go back to that word that my wife gave us, even discerning about who we're taking consultation from, who we're consulting from. We just have to be discerning, because here's the thing, Sanballat, man, they've been plotting. And this is one thing that we're going to see as we continue on. But I remember Apostle saying this. It's like, man, people that are doing evil, they have help to do it. They have help. So these people are this Sanballat and Geshem. So now they got help to be able to create these lies. Now, remember, these aren't just regular people lying. These are governors. These are governors. And so you got these governors, people, and the rest of the enemies, as Nehemiah said. So you had armies and governors. And so this isn't just a light thing for them to now come up with a lie. And I'm not going to go into this whole, because, I mean, good Lord, we could talk about this political state and things that have been conspired against and the lies and some of the stuff. Anyways, but we got to be discerning and mindful of ourselves, because guess what? People will lie against you. They will lie. They will send, if it's not an open letter, they'll send an email, or they'll send a tweet, or they'll send something else to somebody else. And then here's the thing, after they create a lie, but then they'll say, but hey, they'll try to sound like they're well-meaning and well-intentioned. Well, hey, you know what? I kind of heard that this is going on, and we believe that this is your intentions, even though you know it's not your intentions. But they'll be saying, even though we think that this is your intentions, let's just have a conversation about this. We want to consult just to kind of see where things are, because we don't want you to get in trouble. All right. So again, one yes must be defended over time by 1,000 no's. And so we got this letter from these governors. And so here we go in verse 8. Then I sent to him saying, so Nehemiah still hasn't left from his position. He hasn't left his place of work. He hasn't left his place of duty. Nehemiah hasn't left his assignment. He has not come up off his assignment. He's anchored in it. He's anointed for it, but he's anchored in an assignment. How is he anchored in it? Because the hand of the Lord is upon him. So when you got the hand of the Lord that is upon you, then you don't want to get up from under that hand. And so if the hand doesn't move, guess what? You don't move. You want to be, I kind of saw this illustration. If God's hand is on a work, then God, this is what we want. God's hand, one hand on a work. Because we want his hand first on the work, right? God's hand on the work. Then we want God's hand upon us, right? So that way, his hand is on this work. Then his other hand is on us. And then we want to make sure that his other hand that is on us, then he brings us to the work that his hand is on. Got you got that illustration? So his hand is on the work first. Then he places his hand upon us, right? So now he places his hand upon us, brings us to the work that his hand is on. But then he says this, my hand is on this work. My hand is on you. Now you put your hands to what my hands is on, to what my hand is already on. And so we want to stay there. We don't want to come up off of that. Here, you got five times now, five different opportunities where Nehemiah was tempted and perhaps even threatened in this letter with this lie. But Nehemiah could not get up off that work. So here we go. Verse 8. Then I sent him, saying, no such things as you say are being done, but you invent them in your own heart. So he sends that message back to them. I love it. Nehemiah did not leave to have this conversation or this consultation in person. No, but he stayed put. Verse 9, for they all were trying to make us afraid, saying their hands will be weakened in the work and it will not be done. Now, therefore, O God, strengthen my hands. So now we see here. You got that illustration that we just talked about, right? But now we see that the enemy tried to speak against. First of all, this is what you got to understand. When the enemy speaks against your hands, then whose hands, based upon the illustration that we just talked about, whose hands are they really trying to speak against? They're speaking against the hand of God. And the hand of God, I'm telling you, we've got to stay in his presence and under his hand, because in there is provision, in there is protection, in there is prosperity, there's power. And so we look at it again. So they try to speak. First, they try to bring fear. But then they try to say their hands will be weakened. So they try to prophesy against the prophetic work that was already going on. They try to prophesy against what was already prophesied out of Nehemiah's mouth, saying that we will build this wall. We will restore these gates. And so you see this continuance. So whenever there's an apostolic work, guess what? There's still some things that have to be plowed. There's still whenever there's a good thing going on and a God thing going on, then there's going to be resistance. But we can't run away because of the resistance. I'm slightly ahead of myself, but I just got to say that we can't run away and turn tail and tuck our tails in because of the resistance. Well, Lord, you see their threats? No, this is what we say. This is what we say. And so this is what we say right here. So while people are speaking against and saying that your work will be weak and it will not be done, then this is what we say. Now, therefore, O God, strengthen my hands. Somebody just, again, you got to lift up your hands right now, but just say it again. God, strengthen my hands. God, strengthen my hands for this work. Because guess what? Sometimes if it's not fear, then sometimes fatigue can creep on you. And then you just feel so weak and so drained. And so we just want to be aware of what the enemy will try to do, because there's life that is available for us, that is part of us. And so we even have a scripture to stand on. Let the weak say what? I am strong. So even if fatigue tries to come in, then guess what? We have an answer. We even talked about that, how Nehemiah says, oh, I hear you, but I have an answer. I hear you, but I answered them. I hear you, but I answer. So again, don't be silent in this season. You got to say something. So somebody to say again, now, therefore, O God, strengthen my hands. Can you say it again? Now, therefore, O God, strengthen my hands. Now I might need to repeat this a little bit more so that way you understand that this is an actual invocation, that we're saying this personally. This ain't just about Nehemiah now. But now you envision your hands right now and the work. And somebody now just say it again. God, strengthen my hands. God, strengthen my hands, meaning strengthen my ability. Some people are actually learning some things new right now to add to your ability. Some people are learning a new skill right now to add to the anointing. So you can even say that same thing. God, strengthen my hands, strengthen my ability. God, strengthen my understanding. God, strengthen my resolve. We're going to get back to that word. God, but God, strengthen that. And then guess what? With that prayer, then God continues to strengthen. And what is he strengthening? He's strengthening that yes. He's strengthening your ability to stand and endure. Come on, warriors. Come on, kingdom warriors. He's strengthening that. And so in this hour, like never before, guess what we need? We need strength. Because there's going to be a whole lot of men's hearts fainting because of news and the things that have already been released in the spirit realm that are from the realms of darkness. But we want to make sure that we stay in the hands of God so that way we don't succumb to that. And to that information and to any attacks of the enemy. And guess what? We don't have to. If we feel like that there's weakness, if there's fatigue or anything, then we can say, God, Lord, I'm just kind of sensing this right now. And it could very well be an attack. But Lord, I thank you for strengthening me right now. And then with that, I believe that with your breath and the breath of God just comes and just, and then you get his strength. This is supernatural. It's supernatural because this ain't just I'm taking my vitamins or things of that nature. That is good. But no, we need something that is beyond just even those vitamins and those supplements and even the diet. No. We need that divine impartation and that supernatural strength and breath of God to give us strength. Yeah. Come on. So somebody just say it again. Lord, therefore, strengthen my hands. Oh, yeah. Strengthen my hands. Verse 10. Afterward. Whew, man, Nehemiah was going through some stuff and we ain't even got to the half of it yet. Afterward, I came to the house of Shemaiah, the son of Deliah, the son of Mehetabel, who was a secret informer. Oh my gosh, I don't even have time to talk about all this. A secret informer, and he said, let us meet together. So now, hold up, this is another person here. You've already got Sanballat. You got Geshem that have sent these letters. You got Tobiah. You've got these armies. And now we have this secret informer. And he says this, continuing on in verse 10. He says this now. Someone else now saying, let us meet together. But look at this. He said, let us meet together in the house of God within the temple. Sounds like a good thing, right? And let us close the doors of the temple, for they are coming to kill you. Indeed, at night, they will come to kill you. Now, let me pause here just for a moment. Because God has already set up Nehemiah, one, for being a cupbearer, to being a governor and doing this work. But this is one thing, again, as we're doing this, as we're seeing this, we see that when God has a plan to set you up, guess who else also has a plan to set you up? The enemy. The enemy also has the plan to set you up. But here's the thing about the enemy. I'm telling you, if you weren't able to, or whatever the case may be, if you didn't sign up for the Kingdom Warrior Institute, the class that is going right now with Mike Dyson, man, he just dropped the nugget that I had to write down because it kind of coincides with this. And he said in so many words, if truth is modified, then it's no longer truth. And I was like, whew. So I'm just releasing that to you all. And then, so again, if truth is modified, even if it seems like it's a good thing, but if it's a modification, if something is off, then guess what? The whole thing is gone. Have you ever cooked something before and then one ingredient was off and then everything just was just terrible? I remember doing this, trying to make some healthy kind of pancakes and they wasn't coming out right and they didn't taste all good. And then when I look back at the ingredients, I was like, oh my gosh, I didn't include baking soda. And then when I include baking soda, everything came out right and tasted a whole bunch better. But I had to throw all that work that I did before, I had to throw it out because it was compromised. So now you've got the secret informer, right? Coming to him and saying, hey, Nehemiah, these people are trying to kill you. Let's go to the temple. Let's close the doors and let's just make sure that we do this. But Nehemiah, and again, his perception, because of his focus, his perception was so on point because the hand of God was upon him. And I got to say this right now while it's coming to my mind. Now, remember, we talked about when the hand of God is upon you, and not that God is limited, because he's got his hand on his work. He's got his hand on you. But man, God's got hands all over. But then he also reveals the hand of the enemy. That's what I want to say there. While his hand is upon his work and his hand is upon you, and you're putting your hands to what his hands on, then God will reveal the hand of the enemy. And so we see this right here. Verse 11. And I said, check this out. And it sounds like a good thing, but okay. And I said, to such a man as I flee. Remember, we're not turning or tucking our tails from this great work. To such a man as I flee, and who is there such as I would go into the temple to save his life? I will not go in. So Nehemiah knew that, look, this is a holy place. And of course, even though I'm a governor, but it's like, look, I'm not, that ain't something that I'm supposed to be doing. I can't go into the temple. And here I'm supposed to be going into the temple with a secret informer because, quote unquote, some people are going to kill me. Man, look, I'd rather have them kill me than God take his hand off me. Oh, man. Come on. Come on. So again, when you say yes to God, you have to say no to sin. And I know that word, that triple letter word, that three letter word sin, some people want to brush past it. But guess what? It is real. If you want to deny sin, then you got to deny the cross, and you can't. Because that's what Jesus went for, and that's what he forgives us of, amongst other things. Shucks. Yeah. So, and even when we talk about communion later, shucks, man, that's what the blood, oh my God. So anyways, so Nehemiah was saying, it's like, look, I can't go into the temple. One, I can't go into the temple because I've given my yes to God to be in this good work. And so if I die doing this great work, then I die. But I'm not going to commit this sin against my God. I'm even thinking right now, this is so amazing because this is something, you know, that even it's a perspective that even comes beyond the law. This is a conviction that God gives. It's when we say yes to him. Y'all remember Joseph? Yeah, when he was in Potiphar's house. And again, this was pre-Moses, when Moses gave the law. Joseph, when he was being tempted, remember when he was being tempted by Potiphar's wife and she lied on him? And she was like, well, my husband is away. Come and lay down with me, Joseph, because Joseph was a good looking brother. And she was like, come and lay down with me, Joseph. And Joseph was like, look, Potiphar gave me all this authority and rule over everything pertaining to his house except you. I'm not messing with you in so many words. But she still lied and say this. But then Joseph said this. He said, how can I commit this sin before God? So he already knew adultery was wrong in his heart before there was a law saying adultery is wrong. Oh, my God. Woo. So there are some principles that are already true before Moses even established it as a law. Maybe when we talk about that time of giving, maybe that might come back out again about the tithe. But that principle was something that was already taking place even before Moses came out with a law. Abraham gave tithes. So I just say all that to say this. When we say yes to God, we say yes in every area. But that means that we have to resist and say no to all those other temptations. And we don't want to compromise. And so there's a whole lot of compromise that goes on. And so now, because people's yeses, a lot of people's yeses are real. It's weak and it's fake gold. It might look like a yes, but then when the fire comes, it can't stand the heat. It begins to melt along with the dross. See, what happens is gold, when you apply that heat to it, then that other stuff melts off. And then you get the real value. You get the true treasure of what gold is. But then you realize something is fake under that same heat, then it's going to melt along with everything else. And so that's not the quality of people that we're going to be. And this, truthfully, that's not the quality of vessel I believe that God has called us to be. We want to be vessels of honor, those vessels of gold within the temple for his service and for his use. Oh, yeah. Somebody say, my yes is yes and my no is no. Now, again, Nehemiah said yes. But look at how many times that we've seen already as we've been going through the scripture. Look how many times he had to say no. He had to keep saying no. So I want to encourage somebody right now. Guess what? Some things you have to keep saying no to. Oh, man, can I talk about some of those exes in relationships right now? For somebody that's given a yes and say, Lord, I'm just committing my body to you. I'm committing my heart. I'm committing my soul. I'm forgetting those things which are behind. I'm talking about relationally and romantically speaking as we got Valentine's Day coming up next Sunday. But somebody right now, maybe this can anchor your yes. It's like, Lord, I gave this commitment to you. My body is no longer my body, but it is yours. I can't just do anything with it. I can't just give it away to anybody. Oh, receive the strength of the Lord right now. Somebody to say, Lord, strengthen my body. Strengthen my body. Yeah, no, that's a real thing. I'm kind of sensing this right now. That's a real thing. And so God will provide strength for you. But that means also that your hands actually have to do a work. His hand is on this. His hand is on you. But now that means if somebody gives a call or gives a text, then guess what you have to do? You have to deny that or not respond. The resolve. We're going to get to this resolve, but you got to have that resolve. My goodness. I got to say it again. And I said, should such a man as I flee? And who was there such as I who would go into the temple to save his life? And I love it. In my translation, which you see right here, it says it with an exclamation mark. I will not go in. And I believe he's just kind of saying this to. Yeah, he's just saying it to him. He's like, look, I will not go in. I will not. I've already had to deal with four messengers and I had to deal with this letter. And now I'm dealing with you, the secret reformer. No, I will not go in. Verse 12, we see the hand of God showing the hand of the enemy. Then I perceived that God had not sent him at all. God had not sent him at all, but that he had pronounced this prophecy against me. Because Tobiah and Sanballat had hired him. Oh, my God. So he perceived. Woo. Yeah. Man, when you're focused, when you're in the focus, that God-given focus, that God-given abilities, I'm telling you, that perception is going to come up. Especially when you're working on what he's already established his hand on and his hand is upon you. And God then begins to reveal the hand of the enemy, meaning to sharpen your discernment and sharpen your perception. Oh, and here's the thing. It sounded good, but it was a compromise to that. Man, it sounded good. Look, people are going to kill you. Go to the temple. People are going to kill you. Run. Save yourself. Save your life. Self-preservation. It's like, nope. It ain't even about self-preservation. God, you got to preserve me. God, you got to preserve me. Yeah, remember, because it ain't about you. Can you imagine? Yeah, okay, so yeah. Can you imagine? I'll say that now. Can you imagine if he would have done that? The people that were with him, that were building, if they would have saw us like, hold up, Nehemiah, the governor who said that we're going to build this temple, what's he doing in the temple? He's not a priest. He's not a Levite. It could have thrown off the whole work and the sanctity of what they were putting their hands to. It could have compromised the whole. Oh, yeah. His compromise could have brought compromise to everybody else or could have compromised the whole work. And so Nehemiah perceived this. He was like, wait a second. Man, God didn't send you. And this ain't a prophetic word. But this is how you know that the Holy Ghost revealed it. He was like, hold up. Sanballat and Tobiah. It's like, man, they hired you. They hired you to say this prophecy. And then verse 13. For this reason, he was hired that I should be afraid and act that way and sin. We see that, right? And sin so that they might have cause for an evil report that they might reproach me. that they might reproach me. So you got to be mindful, and we want to be discerning because, again, I said this before, but I got to say it again. In this age, in this decade of the mouth, there's going to be a whole bunch of voices. And Jesus even talked about false prophets and things of that nature. And people will say, this is the Messiah, and there's the Messiah, or there's the Christ. But Jesus said, no. Don't. Somebody just say right now, no. I realize I've been saying that more and more. No. But we have to be discerning. We have to be discerning because some people will be hired. Some people will want to get the church off their assignment, and so they'll send prophetic voices. Well, hey, you know what? Maybe you don't need to gather, or maybe you don't need to do this commission, or maybe you don't need to do this. And it'll even be governors and business people that'll hire, quote unquote, hire influential, compromising, but influential pastors that have platforms. And it'll be saying compromising messages that could potentially deceive the church. But that's why we got to stay in his presence. Because when you stay looking at the truth, then you'll be able to understand a counterfeit. You'll be able to recognize a counterfeit. And so we got to stay here, and we have to stay in his presence, because the counterfeits and the deception that'll be coming will be so great. It'll be so great. And it'll be so close. It'll sound such like a good thing. It sounded like a good thing. This is the temple. It's like, well, Nehemiah, you're rebuilding the walls, man. Go to the temple, man, because of your life. Look, you want this work to keep going? They're trying to stop the work. Go to the temple. It's like, nah, that's a sin if I did that. I can't go in there. And then especially with you. So, again, we have to be discerning. And so he says, for this reason, he was hired that I should be afraid and act that way and sin so that they might have cause for an evil report, that they might reproach me. And so even as a ministry, even just have your business affairs. I'm just getting this now. Even having your business affairs in check. Because people will try to say, well, hey, you need to do this, or hey, go with this contractor, or go with that lawyer. Still, just be discerning about even agreements, because sometimes people or the enemy will use people. And next thing you know, if you're just taking their word and aren't praying and aren't seeking God's face for the ultimate consultation, then you can wind up having something, some paperwork or something that's just off and wrong. And then people can bring a reproach to the ministry, or bring a reproach to your business, or bring a reproach to whatever it is that you just put your hand on. So I just think that's just a good piece of advice for somebody. Just check, get wisdom, get consultation, get other people to be able to pray. Myself, our ministry leadership team, our apostle, our prophet, overseer, Pastor Gabriel, Minister Marlena, Pastor Payson, just get some people to be praying for you, to be able to have some other eyes, to be able to perceive. Amen. All right. So here we go. So that way they might bring a reproach for you, and we're just not going to be reproached in Jesus' name. Verse 14, and this will be the last verse that I'll stop here. My God, remember Tobiah and Sanballat according to these their works, and the prophetess Noadiah and the rest of the prophets who would have made me afraid. Oh, my God. So he says, Lord, remember them people. Remember Tobiah. Remember Sanballat. Remember the prophetess Noadiah. Remember the prophetess Noadiah and those people that will make me afraid. Now, here's something that is very strong that I want us to take a look at here. Don't allow the enemy to yoke fear with your focus. No, don't allow the enemy to yoke fear, to couple fear with your focus, because that's the thing that he'll want to do. That's the place where he operates. No. We want to be yoked up to his presence. We want to be yoked up in faith and staying trusting in him. But again, the enemy will try to bring fear. And so here's how the fear can kind of come about, especially when you get in focus. Sometimes some of the things you'll be like, well, man, I I don't want to offend anybody because of my focus. So if they start to say this or say I need to meet with them or go here with them or go there with them, then I just got to do it because I don't want to offend them, even though I'm focused. But because of whatever, I don't want to offend them. I'm afraid of how they might respond. You know, if I say no to their offer, to their proposition. No, that's a type of fear. And so we don't want to be, I'm telling you, when you're focused, guess what? You're going to have to say no to some things and some people. And especially these people that aren't really praying. if they're doing more plotting than praying, and you could tell by their fruit. Let me just say that. Let me just put that factor in there. You could tell by their fruit. Just look at their fruit. Glory to God. So again, we don't want to be afraid because guess what? Being focused, some people will be offended, but that's okay. Nehemiah said this, Lord, remember them folk, because some people, it could be genuine. And if they love you, if they understand that the hand of God, they see it on your life and they see the hand of God on the work that you're doing, then their response should be like, oh, OK, you know what? I got you. I understand. Maybe we could circle back in time another time. But then, hey, you stay focused. Stay on that great work. Shucks, I'll even undergird you in prayer. I got you. I understand. Those are the type of people. Those are the type of people that we want to say yes to so that way they can stay in our life. Some other people, some of the other conversations, we just got to say no. And I'm starting to realize this more and more, just even as we get into focus and zone in. It's like, look, you can't just entertain anything. It's like, yeah, nah, Lord, I got to be about the kingdom, got to be about your business, got to be about my wife, my family, my children. The plan of God. Come on. Yeah, somebody say, I am doing a great work and I am not coming down. And so this is one thing I mentioned about resolve, a couple of times, just even today. But this is one thing again, you know, when I was just getting ready to come here, I believe that one thing that God's heart for us today is to strengthen our resolve. And I believe God is saying, hey, I'm going to strengthen your resolve for your yes. And it's a whole lot that comes to it. But I believe even in this word that he is anchoring our yes. He is strengthening our hands, but anchoring our yes. Because, and again, when I believe that I heard him say, it's like, I'm going to strengthen your resolve. And I asked, Lord, I was like, well, Lord, how can my resolve be strengthened? How can my resolve even be strengthened? And then he just reminded me of Nehemiah and just his life of prayer. But that life of prayer so much, and that when our yes is in such a place of resolve or resolution, then that allows us to keep repelling with the no's. That allows our no's to keep repelling, you know, the insects of the enemy that tries to come about. And so we want our no, our yes to be resolved and to stay in there. But then guess what? That means that we still got to keep saying, nope, I can't do that. It's like, oh, man, that sounds like such a great opportunity. It sounds like such a great thing. But now I really got to lay into this right now. Even some specific things that I know, just even personally, Lord's like, hey, you know, there's some things that I spoke, but I need you to lay into this specific area even more. Like for me, and just even on some personal stuff, there's just some more revelation I got to come into as it pertains to reconciliation. Yeah, because even though the world might talk reconciliation, the Lord just reminded me, he's like, look, they don't have that anointing. So he was telling me, he's like, look, don't turn tail just because everybody's talking about reconciliation now. They don't have my presence. My hand ain't on it. They can talk all they want, but everything that they'll build up will fall down. So I just say that to encourage you, because God might be placing something upon you and giving you a work. And you can look at somebody else and start comparing and say, well, man, they're already doing that. They're already doing that. But the Lord says, hey, did you give me a yes? Then I need to strengthen that. And you need to say no to that thought to stop, to cease the great work that I've given you to do. Because guess what? They can't do it the way that you do it. Even a prophetic word, some people might be saying, guess what? It ain't backed by my spirit. So God is looking for his people that have been purified, that have been in the fire, that have been consistent and in his presence. He's like, look, I still need you to speak uncompromisingly. So again, don't turn tail. Be like, oh, and just flee. Just like, well, no, because then if you do it, then people are just going to say, well, no, we don't even need what you got because we already got it. And then you just need to understand. It's like, no, you don't got what I got. How do I know you don't got what I got? Because God gave me what I got. He didn't give what he gave me to you. What I have is different. And so it's needed, but guess what? You still got to stay in that yes. I remember another prophetic word, and this had happened a couple of different times. People that didn't even know me or have any type of relationship, but then just in a brief meeting, in a brief conversation on a couple of different occasions, you know, I've heard different, and these were like, you know, elder women in the faith. And they would just say in so many words, like, baby, the Lord says you still got another yes to give. And I was like, what, another one? Another one? Now I've been learning to appreciate that. And then even the times that I've heard Bishop Joseph Garlington, just the times that I've been in his presence, you know, while he's been ministering. And then when he would say some messages on a couple of different occasions, just to talk about giving our yes to God. And then I just realized, I was like, oh, Lord, you know what? There's more to give. There's more to submit to. There's more of myself that I need to die to and yield to, so that way what he desires in and through my life can be able to come forth. So that way now, as it pertains to my own time, as it pertains to our own time and our own schedule, guess what? There's some things that we have to say no to. If it's a moment where we weren't, let me say this. Sometimes it's good to just get before the Lord, even in the morning. Lord, what is the work that your hand is on today that I need to put my hands to? Lord, what's that one thing that'll be most productive, just even today, that I need to make sure that you're already in the midst? Because God never sleeps nor slumbers, so he's already got plans for the day. And I believe, oh yeah, thank you, Holy Ghost. That's why Jesus, that's why the disciples would see Jesus and they waking up, and he's already coming from a place of prayer, and he's like, okay, let's go here. Why? Because he knew where the hand of God needed him to be, and the hand of God was already on him. And he's like, look, the hand of God is already in this town or in this situation, and the hand of God is on me, bringing me to this work that he's already on. And we see in scripture, Jesus even saying no. And it's like, well, Jesus, can you stay here? It's like, Jesus, Lord, you just did this great work, these great miracles. Lord, can you stay here? Jesus is like, no, I can't. I got to go here next. Focus. He knew when to say no. Oh, my God, I'm seeing this right now. But because he lived this life of yes to the Father, and over time saying no thousands of times, where it came to his greatest moment in the garden, Jesus had to say no to his very self. Lord, let this cup pass from me. Is there any other way? Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Why? Because I've said yes to you, God. I said yes to you even before the I said yes to this plan even before the foundations of the world. How strong is that? Whew. Yeah. Okay. So now I just see this. Can we just lift our hands right now? When we just said, now, oh God, therefore strengthen my hands. I believe it's in the strength of Jesus. Yes. That I believe that he just wants to impart that just more and more to us, that we grow into this, that we just continue to grow and take on the strength of Jesus, of that. Yes. Because Christ is already on the inside of us, that anointing. Lord, so I thank you, Lord, right now in the name of Jesus. Oh, for the strength of your yes and the strength of your no's. The strength of your yes and the strength of your no's, God. May it be upon us. May it be in us, God. May it be such a resolve on us, God, and in us to anchor us in your plan and in your purpose, God, that we understand, Lord. Let it be such a revelation of the great work, God. And I'm not even talking about size, but it's great because your hand is upon it. The work is great because your hand is upon it. The work is great because your hand is upon it. Don't compare. Yeah, I just kind of hear this right now. Don't compare your work to somebody else's. Your work is great because my hand is upon it. You can look at somebody else's and it might look bigger, but it's not greater because my hand is not upon that. Yeah. So now, Lord, I thank you, Lord, in the name of Jesus. May we come into the greater revelation that the work is great, God, because your hand is upon it, Lord, and we will not come down off it. Oh, Lord, even how they told him, come down from the cross. My God, Lord, no. Yeah, God, we will not come down. Oh, not until it's finished. In Jesus' name. Yeah, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God, for the grace, for the great work. Thank you, God, for the grace, for the great work in the name of Jesus. Lord, and where there's been fear, let there be faith in the name of Jesus. Yeah, God. Destroy the yoke of fear that has been upon people. The fear, God, of offending somebody. The fear of missing out on something. No. Destroy that yoke. God, we declare that yoke be broken in the name of Jesus. Yeah, the work is great because your hand is upon it, God. Lord, yeah, and we come against every prophetic false word or ideal, God, that has come across, God, to try to get us off, to try to get us out of position, to try to get us out of place. That has modified truth. No. God, I thank you, Lord, for your truth in its wholeness and in its purity, God. In the name of Jesus, God, may we come into a greater revelation of truth. Even the truth of what you've spoken about, spoken about us and the work that you've called, God. Oh, Lord, I just even sense this, Lord. Even forgive us for some of the things that we've spoken out of our mouths against the work that you've called us to. Maybe sometimes we've heard some things and agreed with that apostate voice. God, we repent and we cancel that contract in Jesus' name, God. And I thank you, Lord, for reviving faith, God, reviving the hope, reviving the love and the passion. Oh, yeah, God. Now we pray that, God. I thank you, God, for just reviving the love and the passion for the work. The zeal and excitement, God, for the work in the name of Jesus. Yeah, somebody just take that on right now. That'll just be such a fervor that you get excited again. Because sometimes you can spend so much time with it. And because it's work and because it's effort, then you can get tired. Sometimes that fatigue can come in. It's like, I don't even want to do this anymore. Nope, God, I thank you, Lord, for reviving the fervor, reviving the zeal, reviving the excitement. Let it be fresh all over again. Even some of the plans that have been written down, let it be fresh all over again in Jesus' name. Oh, yeah. Let it be such a youthful exuberance, God, part of that strength. Let it be such a youthful exuberance, God, come forth in Jesus' name. Yeah, let it be a youthful strength, God. Let it come forth. Renew it even now, God, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And let us see, God, this is just even a portion, God, because even as we have written down the vision, Lord, that's just a piece of the end from the beginning. Let us go back and revisit it. And I thank you, God, for breathing upon it afresh in Jesus' name. Some of you have to replay the prophecies. Some of you have to go back and look at that vision again. Yeah, but it's a great work. Don't come down from it in Jesus' name. Even the work that we have as this ministry, it's a great work. We are not coming down from it. Yeah, in Jesus' name. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Bless the name of the Lord. We thank you for it, God. And somebody just say, Lord, I'll receive your strength in Jesus' name. Yeah. And so it's just going to come again more and more. I believe it'll just be a supernatural infusion, a supernatural infusion, even so much so that you'll have to still guard your time. Lord, but we thank you for that supernatural infusion in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. My God. Well, I want to give this invitation as well. I'm telling you, while we are in this vein, if you've never prayed to receive Jesus Christ into your life, let me do this. I really just kind of sense this. For those, maybe you've prayed that prayer, but you got off track and you got out of fellowship. Then I just kind of sense this is really just a moment of rededication, recommitting your life. Yeah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Yeah. Because that's that. Yes. Yeah. Because many of you have said, yes, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. And then you kind of maybe got off, maybe got distracted, maybe got pulled away or got snared by temptation or even got ensnared by the fear of men, that would come against your walk with Jesus. No, but I'm telling you right now, the Lord says, look, I still love you. And I believe that he's just extending his hand and saying, hey, will you take my hand again? It's like, my hand is still on the work that I've called you to, but my hand upon you, will you take my hand again? And will you walk with me again? And so I know some of you are just sensing, some of you just matter of fact, just say right now, just say, yes, Lord. Yeah, and now follow me just in the rest of this prayer. Say, Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sin. I say yes to you again. And I thank you for your hand being upon me and your hand upon my purpose. And I thank you for your hands being on my life, centering me in your will. I say yes to you with my lips. I say yes to you with my heart. I say yes to you with my mind. I say yes to you with my body. In Jesus' name, amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. I believe somebody, you know, whether in this stream right now or even at a later point, somebody just really sensed the presence of God and that conviction, but have said yes to him. And so, you know, what we want to do, we want to celebrate. We're not going to be ones that just prophesy to get you out of in temptation to get you off course. No, we want you centered in the will of God and in his plans and, you know, in all of that. But I'll ask you to do this. Go to our website. You'll see it before you now at agfwc.org/newlife. There's a resource that is available for you that you can read and encourage you and gain that strength written by one of our elders. Very powerful resource to help you in your maturation and growth with the Lord. But then also, once you even download that resource, contact our ministry. Let us know. We have a team of intercessors to be able to pray with you, pray for you. And then we also want to thank God for just your recommitment, your rededication as well. It's a big thing. But then I say this. Don't worry about the enemy that'll try to come and say, ah, you didn't mean it from your heart. I'm telling you, I believe that God was so in you, leading you to pray that prayer, because you can't do it without him. I believe that he was with you, leading you in that prayer. Now he's just afresh on the inside of you. So you're not alone. You don't have to walk this life alone. We're called a body of Christ for a reason. And so even as a result, you know, we'll be taking communion later on. You'll be able to do it just as afresh, a part of the body in Jesus' name. Amen. So we do honor God and we do celebrate him. And so can we just lift our hands one more time? Lord, we thank you for this word. God, and even right now, Lord, we just give you just a fresh yes, just a fresh yes, and even a deeper yes, a deeper yes. And we thank you, God, for just, again, this great work that you've called us to. And even if it's a business or a business idea, guess what? That's still a ministry in God's hands. So it doesn't just have to be, quote unquote, church or temple related. Some of you are doing things that impact cities. Guess what? Yeah, we still say yes to that. Oh, it all works together. The temple, the city, and God's blessing us as well, God. So we say yes, and we thank you for that. You said, yeah, Lord. Okay, yeah. Lord, you said yes first. And so now we say amen. Yeah. Yeah. All the promises are yes and amen. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yeah. In Jesus' name. And so we do thank God for this. And I know today is the first Sunday of the month. And so we're just going to prepare our hearts right now to take communion. And then I'll be back up just to share some announcements. But we will be led, you know, in our communion by our founder of this this great work, Apostle Harry Jones. Amen. Amen.
Well, praise God this morning. The word of God is fresh today, again, as always. Pastor Walt, Lord's put his heart on us focusing. And so today is communion, and we're going to focus on communion. Praise God. So if you have your Bibles, I want us to look at 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter, in verse 10. So it's only one chapter and one verse that we're going to look at, and that's 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 10. And Apostle Paul is, again, reiterating about communion and the importance of it. And so from this, we're going to gather some truths that I know I didn't know about, but as the Lord is directing us, he's opened up even more about communion, and I think it's going to be a blessing to all of us. So if you have your Bibles, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 10. And also today's communion, so you may want to get your elements at the end, we can all partake together. So here in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 10, Paul says this, always bearing about in the body the dying of our Lord Jesus. And then he says that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. Let's read that again. Always bearing about in the body of the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest where? In our body. We must remember this, that every time we take communion, we are participating in the death of his death on the cross. Okay? And that we become one with him in his sufferings. So when we read the very first part of this scripture, we'll notice one thing, and then we read the other half, you'll see another thing. And what we're talking about is this. When he says always bearing about in the body of the dying of the Lord Jesus Christ, he's talking about us as the body of Christ. Okay? When we read the second part of that, that the life also of the Lord Jesus Christ, of the Lord Jesus, might be made manifest. Notice what it says. Notice what it says in what? Our body as an individual. The first part is talking about us as the body. The second part is talking about us as the individual. Okay, now, what we need to realize that when we take the bread and we take the juice or the okay, then we got to remember something. Remember, Jesus' body was broken. Okay, it was broken for what purpose? When his body was broken, it was broken for our benefit. Because his body, they put stripes on his back. And he was whipped. And he shed blood. Okay? So his body being broken, and there was our body now to be broken, to be able to break off sickness and disease, okay, that would come to our bodies through his broken body. Now, I want us to as we look at this, in the first part, we said it's about the total body. But now he's making it personal, our body. So when he says that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body, he's talking about so that healing can manifest in our body. Yes, when we take these elements, these are not something just supposed to put away and store away in our memory. Okay? What Jesus has done for us, what he has done for us, we are supposed to make it known what he's done for us. We got to say what he's done for us, okay? So today I want us to release our faith when we take these elements today. Release our faith, okay? And a lot of times we just take for granted, oh, it's just Sunday, it's the first Sunday, okay? And we just go on to get it over with, and then we go home, okay? No, God, when Jesus shed his blood and took those stripes, he wants you to experience healing. He don't want you to talk about healing. He wants you to experience a healing. So when sickness comes, man, sickness has one purpose, man, is to break your body down, to take you out, and to cause you to leave here before your time. So the Bible says, why die before your time? Everybody dies, it's not our time. And God doesn't want us to die of sickness. But we know people do die of sickness. But Jesus died so we won't have to die of sickness. He paid the price. Yes, he did. And that's why we look to Jesus. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. Now, I want to go over and say this. We want to release our faith. So when we take communion, what we're doing today, we are reliving what he did. Okay? A lot of times, we want to keep it in his memory. But when Jesus says, when you do this, okay, you're doing it in remembrance of me, He didn't say, I want you to keep this in your memory. I want you to relive what I did. That's a whole different ball game right there. And many of us, we're just keeping it in our minds. Oh, it's communion, and we just go on, but we never get the benefit. The Bible says, bless the Lord, O our soul, and all within me. Bless his holy name. What does he do? He forgives us of all our iniquities. He heals us of all our diseases. Amen. So that's a blessing. So he says, when you do this, he didn't say thank this. He said, do this. And when you do this, we're doing this. Okay, we're rethinking what he's done. Okay, not memorizing it, we're rethinking. In other words, what you, as a man thinks, so is he. So when we think it, we're going to do it. Amen? So that's what we're going to do. So if we're ready, I'd like for you to take the bread. Amen? Amen? Okay, now, this is his body, and so we break it. So when we break it, Jesus' body says, he says, here, take. And he took the bread, the Bible says, and he break it. And he gave it to them. So now we're breaking. In the same breaking, God is breaking off into us his life, his health, and his blessing. So let's take. Then he took the cup. He said, this is my blood. This was shed. Not only do we get reconciled back to God, but the blood cleanses us. And the blood washes us. What can take away our sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make us whole again? Nothing but his blood. So let's all partake. I don't know. I don't have a word of knowledge about who's sick and or what part of your body's hurt or broken or in pain. But I do know this. The Bible says the name of Jesus is above every name. And so whatever sickness you have, whatever disease you have, whatever infirmity you have, whatever pain you have, whatever discomfort you have, his name is above it. So let's right now, we're going to pray and believe God right now. So if you're hurting in a certain area, you can put your hand on it. Or if you can't, okay, you just release your faith to God. And as we pray, we're going to believe God for your healing. And when it comes, just call us back and let us know what God did. Because God is no respecter of persons. If God did for one, he'll do it for another. Amen. So, Father, we thank you today as we partake and receive your broken body and the blood that you was shed. God, we send forth your healing, virtue, and power to destroy sickness of all kinds, diseases, infirmities that may be upon your people or those who are watching. And God, we thank you right now. We send your word, God, to heal them and to deliver them from destruction. So we call them healed. We call them whole. We call them well. We call them right now, God. We call forth health into their mortal bodies. And Lord, let the peace of God that passes all understanding right now begin to garrison their heart and their mind and their souls right now in Jesus' name. So today, receive your healing. Receive your wellness. Receive your soundness. Be free of pain. Be free of sickness. Be free of disease. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you.
Glory to God. Yeah, somebody says it's just time for manifestation. Yeah, it is time for manifestation. I've referenced this because we're going to get ready to worship God in our giving now. Amen. Yeah, so this is still continued in fellowship. So I've referenced this. This kind of came about, wasn't planned, but it came about in a message. It's even talking about just even principles that were before the law. So I want you to turn with me to Genesis chapter 14. Remember, I talked about Abram and this gentleman named Melchizedek, and I'm not going to go too deep into it. But in so many words, Melchizedek was a manifestation of Christ in the Old Testament. But anyways, because this account deserves its own message, so to speak, or teaching. But Genesis chapter 14, verses 18 through 20. And so this is actually before Abraham's name was changed here. And so then Melchizedek, verse 18, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine and was the priest of God Most High. So Melchizedek was a priest, right? And he blessed him and said, blessed be Abram of God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hand. And he, meaning Abraham, gave him, meaning Melchizedek, a tithe of all. And so, of course, you know, we've actually read this in Nehemiah chapter 10, the tithe even going to, you know, being received by the priest. And so this was something that took place. So this just lets you know just the principle of something of tithing is supernatural. It's supernatural. So it's just beyond the law. I want to see if I can find something else here. Yeah, so here we go. So now this is Melchizedek. So just turn with me now, because that was Old Testament, right? But now we're going to see this again in Hebrews. And this is just talking about the principle of thing, but it's got to be in our heart. But we want to honor God with the tithe in our giving financially. So bear with me, because I'm just going to read this quickly. But this is the same account, but in the New Testament. For this Melchizedek, verse 1, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham, we have Abraham now, returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all. First being translated king of righteousness, and then also king of Salem, meaning king of peace. Now, verse 4, let me skip verse 3. Now consider how great this man was, meaning Melchizedek, to whom even the patriarch Abraham gave a tenth of the spoils. And indeed, those who are of the sons of Levi who received the priesthood have a commandment, have a commandment, have a commandment. This shows up in the New Testament. Some people try to say, well, you know, it's not in the law. Well, this is actually pre-law, but still have a commandment in the law as well. Have a commandment to receive tithes from the people according to the law. That is from their brethren, though they have come from the loins of Abraham. All right, let me continue on verse 6. But he whose genealogy is not derived from them receives tithe from Abraham. Ah, you see how it's supernatural? Receives tithe whose genealogy wasn't even from Abraham, and bless him who had promises. Now, beyond all contradiction, the lesser is blessed by the better. Here, mortal men receive tithes, but there he receives them. Hold up. Let's look at that again. Verse 8. Here, mortal men receives tithes, but there he receives them. We got to look at this one more time, because sometimes you just think that you're just giving financially and it's just a natural thing. It is not. This is a supernatural principle that was pre-law. So it's beyond the law, but it still shows up in the law. But guess what? Now that we're under grace, guess what? It's still a principle, because it's a kingdom thing. So check this out. Here, mortal men receive tithes, but there he receives them. Of whom is witness that he lives. Even Levi, who receives tithes, paid tithes through Abraham, so to speak, for he was still in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. So I'll take another time to really go. I mean, we could do a deeper dive in that, but I just want to let you know, as it just kind of came out. And again, it wasn't in my thinking. It wasn't in my meditation. Just even talking about that. But in the midst of the message, I believe God just wanted to let us know. It's like, look, there's some principles that we get to operate in beyond that. So we're actually doing something that is supernatural. So now, as you prepare to give, understand this. You're not just giving it to Abounding Grace Family Worship Center. Here, mortal men, we do receive them, and we're going to bless them. But guess who receives them as well? Our great high priest, Jesus Christ. Amen. So now, glory to God. Because it's supernatural, we're just going to do offering reading number 2. Oh, but before we do that, the ways you can give. Remember, the ways you can give. Can somebody just thank God right now, even before we do that, just for just the supernatural seed that we have? Whatever it is that is 10% of your income and increase, that God is, again, this is part of the strength. I believe that's that he'll strengthen your ability for even producing in this season. Yeah. God, I thank you, Lord, for strength. Oh, okay. Now lift your hands before we go to our declaring over the seed. Does someone say, Lord, strengthen my hands to produce wealth and resources in this season. Yeah. Yeah. In Jesus' name. And Lord, we thank you for the wisdom that'll come with that. My goodness. So, yeah, so our hands will be strengthened for that because God's hand is already in the work. And I just believe, I'm not saying everybody got to have a jet, but I don't believe we as believers need to be broke. No, we got to be able to have more than enough to be able to be a blessing to other people. Amen. All right. So come on with the supernatural seed, the way in which you can give. You can text to give. That number to text to give is 77977. That number again is 77977. And you'll see it. You can put AG family in the message. Hit send. Follow the prompt from there. For those that desire to write a check, we receive that as well. And thank you for sowing that way also. We pray that your seed will come straight through the mail system. And of course, that P.O. box is what you see before you, 2036. And of course, that's our locale there. And you can write it out to AGFWC. And then for those that want to give online through a laptop device or computer, that is our website there. And you can go there or hit the give tab and follow the prompts from there. Amen. Now, let's speak this blessing together. You'll see it before you. And we're going to say this together. As we release today's seed, we are believing you for, somebody say it with me, heaven open, earth invaded, storehouses unlocked, yes, and miracles created, dreams and visions, yeah, angelic visitations, declarations, impartations, come on, and divine manifestations, yeah, come on, communion, anointings, giftings, and calls, positions and promotions, provisions and resources to go to the nations, souls and more souls from every generation, saved and set free, carrying kingdom revelation. Thank you, Father, that as I join my value system to yours, you will shower favor, blessings, and increase upon me. So I have more than enough to co-labor with heaven and see Jesus get his full reward. Hallelujah. We thank you, God. We bless you, Lord, for receiving the tithe, not just in earth, God, but you receive the tithe in Jesus' name. And we thank you for the blessings upon it. Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah. Come on. The Lord still receives the tithes. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. So we have some announcements for today. We got a lot going on this month. We have some great work, not just busy work, but we have some great work taking place this moment, this month. So pay attention to our announcements right now.
We want to say a special happy birthday and happy anniversary to all who are celebrating this month of February. May God bless you with his love and uncommon favor.
For those that are on social media, you can help us reach more lives by sharing our content. It's impacting more people than you know. And if you haven't already, be sure to connect with us by subscribing to our YouTube channel and hitting the notification bell. And also on Facebook, be sure to like and follow our page for the latest information and content.
Faith comes by hearing and hearing the Word of God. Subscribe to our podcast and keep listening for a continued focus.
To the men, let's join our founding apostle as he speaks at New Dimensions of Worship Ministries on Saturday, February 20th at 10 a.m., located at 1125 Powell Road, Brookhaven, PA. The theme will be the definition of manhood, and you don't want to miss it. Calling all husbands and wives to join us for our Marriage Enrichment Night, February 26th at 7 p.m. Cake Toppers is about using God's ingredients to make a marriage sweet like a cake, but also a marriage that lasts like a cake topper. This night, we'll be turning up the heat in the kitchen. Registration is free, but space is limited. Be sure to register today on our website.
The Kingdom Warrior Institute is offering another apostolic blast through our virtual workshop, The Worshiping Warrior, with Apostle Alice J. Jones on Saturday, February 27th. If you desire to go deeper in your worship, this is for you. In it, you can expect equipping, fine-tuning, and training for setting the atmosphere and flow of the Spirit of God in your life. For more information and to register, visit our website at agfwc.org.
And stay connected for more information about our upcoming KWI courses. These trainings will sharpen you to be the battle axe and kingdom warrior you've been called to be.
Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So I do want to thank those for those that have signed up and registered for our 6-week course with Mike Dyson. I'm telling you, we already started rocking and rolling this past Thursday, and it is good. And if for whatever reason you were unable to or your schedule didn't allow you to be a part of the 6-week course, as you've seen, and I want to add some more thrust to this, we have an apostolic blast with none other than our dear. She is a spiritual grandmother to me, you know, in the faith, Apostle Alice Jones. And so I'm encouraging you to be a part, register. And some of you might say, well, man, I'm not a psalmist, I'm not a singer. Guess what? If you're a worshiper, the Lord says that, look, I'm seeking for worshipers. Then you need to say, yes, remember? Yes, I am a worshiper. Somebody just say right now, yes, I am a worshiper. Then that means you also. So you're able to be a part of this. And again, you know, anything that we have, you don't have to have a title for this. We part of our vision is to be a place where people can really worship and experience the manifest presence of God, you know, in worship. And so you can experience that. And so with Apostle Alice, she'll be ministering, teaching, but it'll be an impartation as well, just being in her ministry. So register. And then once you register, share it, forward it. It is on our social media as well. It's also on our website. You can send people the link also, but share it. And then also, we've seen the information. I'm not going to say a whole lot about this. I will next Sunday for Valentine's Day. But for all the married couples, we got the Cake Toppers event. So that registration is live and active now. We're going to connect and turn up the heat. And so we'll share more about what that means the night of. And then, of course, for the men in the area, join Apostle. And of course, you have that information. And of course, you'll see that on our social medias. It's on our website for our events page as well. At Pastor Jake Colburn. Whoa, whoa. Yeah, there we go. So it's going to be good. The definition of manhood. Amen. Yeah, because trust me, the world's trying to redefine it, but God's already defined what manhood is. Amen. So again, we are appointed. We got a great work. And so we are continuing to build. So everybody stay locked in, stay focused, and know that the enemy will try to come. People will try to come. Sometimes it can even be family that'll try to come and get us off focus. But we're not getting off this great work. We're not coming down. Amen. Lift your hands. Thank y'all for hanging with us today. I know it's a little longer, but when you're hungry, what is time? The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. See you on Wednesday. God bless you. Stay warm, and we'll see you then.